Buenas tardes. Les pido que hagamos silencio, por favor, que recuerden apagar sus celulares y ya vamos a dar comienzo. Les damos la bienvenida a la ceremonia de apertura del segundo fórum de la Asociación Internacional de Sociología 2012, Justicia Social y Democratización, coorganizado localmente por la Asociación Latinoamericana de Sociología y la Asociación Argentina de Sociología, siendo sus sedes anfitrionas la Facultad de Ciencias Económicas y la Facultad de Ciencias Sociales de la Universidad de Buenos Aires. Contamos con el apoyo y auspicios de la Universidad de Buenos Aires, Facultad de Derecho, Facultad de Ingeniería, Sage Publications, Consejo Latinoamericano de Ciencias Sociales, Ministerio de Turismo, Presidencia de la Nación Argentina, Ministerio de Educación de la Nación y Secretaría de Políticas Universitarias, Presidencia de la Nación. Ente de Turismo del Gobierno de la Ciudad Autónoma de Buenos Aires. El foro ha sido declarado de interés nacional por la Presidencia de la Nación. Presiden este acto Michael Barway, Presidente de la Asociación Internacional de Sociología. Margaret Abraham, Vicepresidenta de la Asociación Internacional de Sociología y del Foro. Alberto Bialakowski, Presidente del Comité Argentino de Organización. Alicia Palermo, Copresidenta del Comité Argentino de Organización y Presidenta de la Asociación Argentina de Sociología. Y Paulo Enrique Martins, Presidente de la Asociación Latinoamericana de Sociología. Los acompañan en el estrado el decano de la Facultad de Ciencias Económicas y vicerrector de la Universidad de Buenos Aires, profesor Dr. Alberto Edgardo Barbieri, y el decano de la Facultad de Ciencias Sociales, Sergio Caletti. A continuación, escucharemos las palabras del presidente de la Asociación Internacional de Sociología, Michael Barway.
Hola. Hola. Buenas noches. That's all. My Spanish is very limited. But we have wonderful translators here. And I'd like to welcome all of you. This is an amazing event. Some 4,000 sociologists are coming together in one place, Buenos Aires. That is going to be very dangerous. 4,000 sociologists in one place. We are really delighted in the ISA to be here in Buenos Aires. It has been our goal to come back to Latin America. It is sad to say the last time we had a big congress was in 1982 in Mexico. And so this is many years later, 30 years later, we are back in Latin America. We're back in a fascinating country, Argentina, with amazing social movements. And we're here in UBA, one of the amazing universities in the world. In fact, Argentinian universities are extraordinary. Argentinian universities are public universities. Argentinian universities have open admissions. You can clap at that too. Argentinian universities do not charge student fees. And Argentinian universities elect their administrators. Argentinian universities are unique in the world. And so it is a great pleasure for us to be part of a very democratic meeting of sociologists. My role here is to welcome you and to introduce the speakers who will also welcome you. My role here is also to pay thanks to so many people who have contributed to making this possible. 4,000 sociologists from 90 countries is no mean achievement. And to thank the people involved would take me extremely long time. So what I would like to do is, first of all, recognize the local organizing committee that's headed by the president and co-president, Alberto Bielakowski and Alicia Palermo. From the ISA standpoint, the president of this forum is Dr. Margaret Abraham, and she has devoted her life to this project. And there is an invisible player who's probably hard at work somewhere else because I don't see her here. Everybody knows her name. Her name is Isabella Barlinska, who has for 25 years been secretary of the ISA. Ah, she is there. Isabella likes to be invisible, but it is my project as president to make her visible. Okay, there is the ISA, but you know, this would never have been possible were it not for the generosity of UBA, the University of Buenos Aires. So we are lucky to have with us today the vice rector of the university, and his name is Alberto Edgardo Bobbieri. And in particular, the university here is an enormous university. It could be housed in many places. We are really so lucky to be able to be in one place where we can indeed build dialogue amongst ourselves. And for that, we must thank the Dean of the Economic Faculty, Dr. Galletti. Thank you very much. There are indeed many other people I can thank. I will not do that. I think other people here may pay their thanks to other people. I am going to now simply introduce the speakers one by one. And we are going to have the orchestra probably will be playing. Anybody know when? When's the orchestra? It's not exactly at the time on the program. We'll decide, Marcella, right? We will decide together. We are going to do some sort of participatory democracy, general assemblies. No, I know that's not how it works here. Yes. Anyway, so we are going to go according to the program, and we are going to start, indeed, with our vice rector.
Buenas tardes a todos. Señor presidente de la Asociación Internacional de Sociología, de la Asociación Latinoamericana de Sociología, de la Asociación Argentina de Sociología, querida doctora Abraham, que todos estos días estuvo trabajando con nosotros y ya me siento medio sociólogo. La otra parte de medio, lo debo confesar, es porque mi hija es socióloga y también de la Universidad de Buenos Aires, cosa que me llena de orgullo, y mi amigo Sergio Caletti lo sabe muy bien, decano de la Facultad de Sociología. La verdad que para nosotros, como Universidad de Buenos Aires, en mi caso como vicerrector y también como decano de la Facultad de Ciencias Económicas de la UBA, es un honor, una enorme satisfacción poder tener a todos ustedes acá en nuestra universidad, en este caso específico en nuestra facultad. Poder ver que más de 80 países, según me dijeron, están participando, cerca de participantes de 200 universidades, más de 3.500 inscriptos, lo que da una idea de lo que es este congreso, que yo tenía siempre noticias de lo que significaba este congreso, pero nunca tuve la posibilidad de verlo tan de cerca. Creía que los economistas solo juntábamos tanta gente, pero veo que los sociólogos también lo hacen. Y el tema en especial que ustedes van a abordar, partiendo también de una disciplina social como es la economía, los profesionales en ciencias económicas, el tema de la justicia social, el tema de la democratización en un mundo tan convulsionado, en un mundo tan complejo desde el punto de vista de los principios éticos, de los principios sociales, de los valores sociales, que tanto los economistas necesitamos del pensamiento filosófico, del pensamiento social, para poder interpretar mejor las diferentes posibilidades de desarrollo de nuestras materias, que no son otra cosa que tratar de que el ser humano viva de la mejor manera posible con los recursos escasos que tiene, y con la mayor inclusión social posible, sobre todo en estas latitudes, en donde, por suerte, estamos en un camino de mayor democratización, con gobiernos que están impulsando tanto, no solo a nivel nacional, sino a nivel regional, políticas cada vez más inclusivas, pero todavía a los latinoamericanos nos falta mucho por andar, vamos por un camino importante. Creo que este tipo de discusiones en lo académico nos van a servir a los futuros líderes que le toquen ejecutar políticas públicas, saber hacia dónde está el horizonte que todos anhelamos. Así que para nosotros realmente es una enorme satisfacción que esta discusión se dé en este ámbito de la universidad, que como bien decía el presidente de la Asociación Internacional de Sociología, la Universidad Argentina, la Universidad Pública, tiene una característica fundamental. Aparte de lo que es el área académica, de lo que es el área de investigación, nosotros tenemos un área de extensión universitaria, de contacto con el tejido social, de relacionarnos fuertemente con lo que pasa a nuestro alrededor, con la sociedad que nos da sustento, para poder intercambiar cada día de manera más fuerte, no solo lo que se realiza en la facultad, sino nutrirnos de lo que pasa afuera y no ser una caja de cristal. Creo que ese es el gran desafío que tenemos los universitarios y por eso me parece que es fundamental este tipo de congresos, este tipo de congresos interdisciplinarios, y estamos muy contentos que haya sido elegida nuestra casa para poder ser sede de esta, juntamente con la Facultad de Ciencias Sociales, donde también vi que se van a desarrollar otro tipo de eventos y es la sede natural donde se desarrolla esta temática. Así que en nombre de la Universidad de Buenos Aires, tengan ustedes todos una muy feliz bienvenida, una feliz estadía, un muy buen congreso, disfruten esto que no se da todos los años y para nosotros son una parte más de la universidad. Las puertas están abiertas desde ahora y para siempre y que lo disfruten y muchas gracias de estar en nuestro país.
Doesn't work. Oh. Ah, very good. Very good. Bueno, thank you. Muchas gracias. Thank you very much for coming and joining us and giving this opening welcoming speech, and in return the International Sociological Association wants to present you with our magazine, which, interestingly enough, is called Global Dialogue, and it comes out in 13 languages, and I have a Spanish hard copy for you. They're very rare copies. Okay, so this will, for Global Dialogue for the next 4 days. So, our next welcomer is indeed Maggie Abraham, the president of this forum, and I don't think she understood quite what she was getting into when she stood for election as vice president for the International Sociological Association. But she undertook the project with persistence and charm. And she actually will now talk to us and welcome us and give a little introduction to the theme that we have all committed to, indeed a very Latin American theme, the theme of social justice and democratization. Maggie Abraham.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Dean Barbieri. Buenas noches. You can see a few of us only know very limited words here. On behalf of the Sociological Association, it is my great honor to welcome you all to the second ISA Forum of Sociology in this wonderful city of Buenos Aires and this amazing university, UBA. After many months of preparation and anticipation, it's hard to believe that this day has finally arrived and that thousands of you are here today. As you know, this forum is organized around three main objectives. One, to provide a meeting place for ISA's research committees, working groups, and thematic groups. Two, to develop a socially significant theme involving public actors and to which the different areas of sociology and social science can contribute, such as a theme that we have chosen today of social justice and democratization. And of course, to hold our interim ISA Research Council business meetings. This forum is a great opportunity to strengthen relations and research collaborations between the ISA, the Association of Argentinian Sociologists, ALAS, the Association of Latin American Sociologists, and to really bring the ISA to another part of the world after 30 years. Truly amazing. Over the last 18 months, a tremendous amount of work has been done, not by a few, but a global community of people into preparing this forum. So it is fitting that I begin by thanking some of you who have helped to make this forum a reality. I want to leave the best for the last. First, I want to thank the 55 ISA research committees, thematic groups, and working groups for their amazing program coordinators, and you need to give them a big hand. Their immense efforts with the hard work and dedication of the members of the local organizing committee headed by Alberto Bielowski, I still say that wrong, Bielokowski, and Alicia Palermo has resulted in what I know will surely be an intellectually stimulating and engaging forum. We have to give a huge, huge thank you to ALAS, AS, and the local organizing committee, many of the members, including Beatrice, who's sitting here. Thank you so much. Marcella Bouquet and MCI, too, have been working. However, I don't know what we would do, and Michael has said it well, without the ISA Secretariat in Madrid, led by Dr. Isabella Barlinska, Executive Secretary, and her staff. Truly amazing. Always working in partnership. They have been incredible in every sense of the word in preparing for this big event. A special thank you to our ISA President, Michael Burowai, who nobody can match with his flair and his brilliance, but also to the Research Coordinating Committee and the Executive Committee, who have been an integral part of this journey. Last, but most importantly, I want to convey a deep appreciation to our generous host, the University of Buenos Aires, but particularly Dr. Alberto Edgardo Barbieri, who I had the pleasure to meet and talk and persuade that we should have it here, the Dean of Economics and Vice Rector, but also to Dr. Sergio Coletti, the Dean of the Social Sciences, for opening this wonderful institution to us. It is such collaboration and coordination that makes such a forum possible. So thank you. I know it's a long list, but we're nearly there. Much thanks to the local staff and volunteers and the liaisons who have been working with our research committees. Thanks also and a welcome To the ALAS president, Paulo Henrique Martins, for being here and your important leadership in this coming year, too. Now, over the course of the second ISA forum, you will have the opportunity to participate in a wide range of sessions, including 4 plenary sessions, 2 open forums, and hundreds of other sessions organized by ALAS, us, and the research committees. I hope the next 4 days are not just a culmination of many months of work, but the beginning of a broader discourse on social justice and democratization. I know Dean Barbieri has to leave, and so before I do my formal address, we will just take a quick pause because I know he has a very busy schedule. Thank you for being here.
Felicidades. Hasta luego.
Now, while some of you may have thought that by now I would be able to give my opening address in Spanish, my son quickly informed me that mi español no está bueno. My son speaks Spanish, so he said, no, don't even try it. So rather than spoil a beautiful language, I will give my opening address in English. Sociology, social justice, and democratization in the 21st century. In July 2012, Radha Krishna, a 40-year-old farmer from Middle Guda, India, tried to commit suicide by immolating himself in front of the governor's house. The police immediately pinned the farmer down and arrested him. In his shirt pocket, they found a note stating that he was committing suicide to protest against the injustice in society. More than a quarter of a million farmers have committed suicide in the last 17 years in India, making for the largest wave of recorded suicides in human history. Many of these individuals faced mounting debts, the inability to get credit from banks, and the failure of their cash crops, all factors associated with neoliberal policies adopted by the states. The tragic consequences of the global economic crisis and political repression can also generate moral shock that leads to resistance and mobilizing for democracy. On December 17th, 2010, Mohammed Bouazizi, a 26-year-old high school-educated street vendor and breadwinner for a family of 8, working in the city of Sidi Bouzid, Tunisia, immolated himself after his livelihood was threatened. A policewoman had confiscated his vegetable cart and its goods, collected the fine of $7, and then, according to witnesses, slapped him, spat on his face, and insulted his dead father. Bouazizi unsuccessfully sought justice from the state. He repeatedly requested meetings with the local officials and had lodged a complaint that was refused less than an hour before he set himself on fire. Bouazizi's suicide tapped into an amplified resentment against rising unemployment fueled by the power of the state and its oppressive policies. A wave of demonstrations in the streets immediately ensued, sparking the Tunisian Revolution and the Greater Arab Spring. The consequences of poverty, lack of opportunity, and gendered violence can be particularly severe for women and children. On December 16, 2010, Maricela Escobedo was shot dead as she continued to protest the lack of justice in the murder of her 16-year-old daughter, Ruby, 2 years earlier. Ruby's body, 39 pieces of charred bone, was found in a dump in Juarez, Mexico. Maricela's fight for justice for her daughter directly confronted a system of sexism, corruption, and impunity. Juarez has been called the city of femicides for the murder of hundreds of young women, often raped and tortured. This border city of 1 million has also been decimated by more than 3,000 murders since 1990, giving it the title of the murder capital of the world. However, these stories are not only about India, Tunisia, and Mexico. In fact, they exist in the most developed countries too. These stories tell us of despair, but also struggles for social justice and social change. They're also emblematic inequalities and both significant challenges to and opportunities for promoting social justice and democratic institutions. These examples also highlight similar injustices in very different societies. Many activists, and Latin America knows much of this, have also highlighted similar injustices in very different societies. They have come together across borders to challenge a global economic and political system that deepens social injustices globally. On October 2011, vast numbers of people, many more than we are here today, took to the streets and squares in over 1,000 cities and 82 countries to end inequality and for global change. They raised their voices to let politicians and bankers know that they do not represent the 99%. Condemning poverty, inequality, environmental devastation, corporate and government collusion, they firmly, but without violence, demanded social justice and insisted that the majority, the will of the majority, be heard. So let me add a few comments on the state of the world. The emergence of the information and high-tech economy has redefined notions of time, space, boundaries, and borders. By altering the social and natural environments, these developments have also changed patterns of global interaction. States have increasingly enabled and accommodated the economic forces of the global market economy, often in the interests of a new class of global transnational elite, but with little opportunities or protections for the poor, marginalized, and dispossessed. Remarkable strides in technology, science, medicine, and communication have been accompanied by deepening social and economic inequalities and the persistence of human rights violations. Over 1.4 billion live in poverty. 3.5 billion, or 50% of the world, live on less than $2.50 a day. Over 780 million people still have unsafe drinking water. That is approximately 1 in 9 people. On the other hand, the 10 richest people in the world are cumulatively worth $395.4 billion. If they created their own country, these 10, they would have the 30th largest GDP of the 182 countries. Now, the International Labour Organization, its annual report on global labour conditions released in April 30th, 2012, has forecast that more than 200 million workers will be unemployed in 2012. 50 million jobs have been wiped out since the 2008 financial crisis, and they do not expect a worldwide recovery in jobs and incomes for at least another 5 years. The recent UN Women's Progress Report notes that there have been strides in women's legal rights, but vast numbers of women continue to be denied the control over their own bodies, including in the United States. Excluded from decisions making and denied the protection from violence, you have 603 million still living in places where domestic violence is not considered a crime. And even where there is some progress in legal frameworks, millions of women report experiencing violence in their lifetimes, and usually at the hands of an intimate partner. The systematic targeting for brutal sexual violence is also characteristic of our modern-day conflicts. Human rights, much of what we're going to talk today, still seems out of reach for large numbers of people and women too. The consequences of poverty, lack of opportunity, can be particularly severe for LGBTQ, ethnic and religious minorities. Deep social inequalities exist, but not only in economic regions, but also within societies, including the wealthiest economies. In the United States, the top 1% control 40% of the total wealth, almost a quarter of the total country's income. There are approximately 50.7 million uninsured in the US, which is roughly 16.3% with no health insurance. Just to put this into perspective, that's 1.5 times the population of Canada. These stark inequalities and injustice have led to growing unrest across the world among those who face the brunt of economic exploitation, social exclusion, and political repression. Issues of social justice and democratization are being pushed to the forefront. We have witnessed the use of new social media, as well as the growth and proliferation of horizontal transnational networks of individuals and NGOs. And we've seen them used during the Arab Spring. Ordinary people across the globe are mobilizing and challenging oppressive social, political, and economic regimes with indomitable courage, striving for social justice and daring against all odds to take the difficult, but by no means linear or standard roads to democratization. In some societies, the struggle to achieve social justice has involved electoral reform and attempts to dismantle the existing state apparatus. In others, it has involved efforts to increase popular participation in state policy formulation and implementation. Still in others, movements have sought to create alternative institutions that embody direct democracy and de-link communities from corporations and the state. The roads taken depend upon the strategies and power relations among the particular states, corporations, and movements. So what is the role of sociology in the 21st century? The 21st century poses its own quagmire of complex issues and formidable dilemmas that require us as a global community of sociologists to increasingly participate as stronger societal stakeholders in building a more just society. We need to have a presence in the media. We need to put forth our perspectives in accessible ways. We as sociologists have much to offer if we form research and teaching partnerships with organizations promoting social justice and democratization. These partnerships deepen our understanding of local manifestations of social justice and democracy and effective transformative strategies in certain social contexts. Now, in a gathering of primarily sociologists, I don't have to recount the history of what we have done. We know that sociologists and social scientists have long been interested in generating research that affects social transformation. Take, for example, the works of Karl Marx, Harriet Martineau, Emile Durkheim, Jane Addams, W.E.B. Du Bois, Annabel Quijano, Gunnar Myrdal, M.N. Srinivas, Susie Castor, Pablo González Casanova, and Florestan Fernandez, to just to name a very few. We're also familiar with transformation brought by groups of sociologists. For instance, feminist sociologists have highlighted gender inequalities and their intersectionality with other forms of inequalities, providing important theoretical frameworks and methodologies and practices to proactively address social justice. They have shown women's contributions and the challenges women encounter in the process of democratization. And you're going to hear much about many of these issues later in the plenary and other sessions. As sociologists have documented, social movements in different parts of the globe have challenged dominant structures and various types of systematic discrimination. Latin American sociologists have historically played an important role in addressing issues of social justice and democratization, very often going against the winds. Surely the social tsunamis of inequality in the 21st century require us as sociologists to critically re-examine and reassess existing theories and methods of research, as well as offer new formulations that can illuminate the ongoing global crisis. The times we live in need more equitable, collaborative relationships between sociologists and larger publics if we wish to contribute to the promotion of social justice and democracy. Activists theorize and have forms of knowledge often devalued in academia, particularly mainstream academia, though this is slowly changing. Collaborations with movements and communities make our scholarship not only more relevant, but also more rigorous, and you'll hear some of this in the open forum. We have to strengthen our theories and methods by partnering with communities not only to document social injustices, human rights violations, political and economic inequality, corruption, government and corporate collusion, but most importantly, for offering paths to global fairness and develop effective strategies for social change. In the process of these collaborations, we have to consider what is meant by democratization in the 21st century. What are the effective forms of contestation? What are the processes of democratic transitions? And how are the social boundaries of communities formed? But let me take a moment here to say the importance of our research must be and is matched by the importance of our teaching. We must ensure as teachers, not just as researchers, that our students and publics see how sociology offers important ways to examine, understand, and influence the world we live in. We need to expand the classroom to be more inclusive, especially when we know education is being excluded to many. And Michael spoke about this example here where it's open admissions. We need to see that we effectively incorporate emergent technologies to create free and open collective spaces for collective knowledge production, consumption, and distribution. So let me conclude by noting that despite all of the violent inequalities that plague the world, I am consistently struck, particularly as a sociologist who works with communities, I am persistently and consistently struck by people's relentless pursuit of justice and democracy. Whether it is Radha Krishna, the farmer in India, Maricela Escobedo in Mexico, Mohammed Bouazizi in Tunisia, the indignados and the hundreds of thousands of Occupy protesters across the world, people are increasingly conscious of the injustices that favor the few at the expense of the many. As a discipline, sociologists need to intensify our focus upon critically addressing the connections and contradictions between globalization, social justice, and democratization. This second ISA forum is timely as it brings us together to truly explore how we as sociologists, as engaged citizens, and as human beings can substantively address issues of social justice and democratization. 4 days with hundreds and hundreds of sessions organized by the ISA research committees, important collaborations with local organizing committee, ALAS and AAS, providing an amazing opportunity to broaden and deepen our sociological lens on social justice and democratization. We get the opportunity to think about the possibilities for how to further and more effectively partner with the broader publics to reduce social inequalities. I am confident that when we look back upon this time, we will see this as a moment when our diverse voices, all those 88 countries, all those thousands of people, all our diverse voices as sociologists come together using our sociological imagination to leave sociological footprints for paths to a more just world. Thank you and welcome once again to all of you.